Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Norris Lee TV. We are in our seventh episode of the third season. I'm keeping count, so yeah.
Welcome. You're getting ready for the Omer. You're ready counting, or we just know how to count from all the
and I haven't isolation. I didn't shave either, so yes, I'm getting ready for the Omer.
Okay, there you go.
But yeah, I don't like the Omer. But
well, we know all about counting, right? I mean, with all these guidelines from the government, how many days you have to wait? You know, five days and not. Us Jews know all about counting.
Exactly. Yeah. Especially when it comes to Tumah and Tahara, you count 7 days. Yeah, we're used to it.
No big deal for us, right?
But, you know, we've had a joyous few days. Purim was lovely, rather different, but I think it was really nice. We did the Megillah online. There was much engagement with that, which was very nice. I'm not sure about going forward, though, because it's really a halachic concession for this year. Those who are isolating, please God, we won't need that next year. But if we do need it, we're here for you. Mm-hmm. Oh, please God, no. Hopefully we don't need it, you know.
we also had beautiful readings in Shul.
We had many readings in person and online, and there was great participation.
Yeah, you know, the Women's Megillah also, they did it as well, you know, in the marquee where Aviva once again, you know, gathered the troops, and they really amazing. You know?
Yeah, they split
it up. I don't know how they do it. They did it, and then they had this.
Do it because they want to.
Yeah, no, they're amazing. Yeah, and then there was a grand one with like 14 shuls came together and did a virtual women's Megillah reading.
Yeah, I saw that on Facebook.
Yes, and then we had the big virtual party, which was lots of fun with Johnny Shine and the Shama.
It was so professional, and I like also that they did it on Zoom rather than Facebook Live. That's my personal feelings for that because
I totally agree.
Because you could see people sitting there in their fancy dress, dancing along with them. It was part of the fun. And all members of our community, I thought it was really nice. And a lot of work went into that, including yourself, Rabbi Nick, and Rabbi Friedman. You're quite talented, aren't you?
Yeah, no, I didn't know. Yeah, the rabbi, when he gets into his music, he loves, it's his favorite holiday. He loves Purim. Mine is Pesach, but his is Purim. And he just totally gets into it and does the music. And he, you know, it's fun. It's exciting. It's great stuff. And Catherine pulled it all together, Yasher Koach, once again, and that was great.
Fantastic. So what we're coming up in tonight's show, well, I'll tell you. You may have heard of an organization called Jnetics. This is totally not Purim related, but this is something which is always relevant any time of the year. We're going to hear soon from the organizers at Jnetics, because I met them, and you shall see the interview now. About various diseases which can be transmitted genetically, and you know, prevention is always better than cure. So they do screening, and I hope you've heard of it. If you haven't, this is surely to raise awareness. If you're past that stage in your life, you may have children or friends or neighbours who are not at that stage, who are at that stage. So please do help to spread the word. So we're going to go over to meet Nicole and Aviva at Jnetics to hear about the important work they do to safeguard our future generations. Okay, so we are delighted now to welcome to Norris Lee TV Nicole Gordon from Jnetics. Nicole is the CEO, and Aviva Lewis, who is the Research Development Officer and the Outreach Manager.
Good evening.
Good evening. Welcome to Norris Lee TV. You are now live to the nation. So I personally have heard a lot about Jnetics, both when I was chaplain on campus and for some various events you've done across the community here, including an event for our shul in November or December. But I wonder if you could just explain to our viewers what Jnetics is all about, how you operate, and really what is your mission statement?
Yes, good evening. Well, Jnetics is the only cross-communal charity in the UK that provides carrier screening for life-threatening GGDs. We are unique in our mission. We are actually the only organisation in the UK that offers this service. And we exist with the aim to try and eliminate, where possible, those devastating illnesses from the Jewish community. And to avoid young couples the heartache of giving birth to babies with one of those rare genetic disorders.
Right, are there specific genetic disorders amongst
the Ashkenazi community.
Correct.
Right. Which disease, may I ask, which ones particularly do you feel you can confidently screen for?
So at the moment, our screening program screens for 9 genetic disorders.
Wow, 9.
The most common one that everybody will definitely have heard of is Tay-Sachs. Yeah. And Tay-Sachs has been screened for many years within the community, probably in excess of 30 years. And in the good old days, that was actually a blood test, and it was a community screening program. We also screen for cystic fibrosis, which is prevalent amongst the Jewish community, but also out with the Jewish community. And the others are probably less common. We screen for a condition called familial dysautonomia, and also we screen for a condition called Canavan's disease. So of the 9 that we currently screen for, there are probably 3 that are more commonly and widely heard of amongst the community.
Right. Okay.
I also want to add, Rabbi, that we are currently going through an expansion of our screening program at the moment. And by the end of 2021, the 9 conditions that we screen for will increase to include more Ashkenazi conditions and also a number of Sephardi conditions.
Oh, interesting. Amazing. And Aviva, as outreach manager, how do you get your message across successfully to various institutions and across the community?
So we do a lot of education of rabbis, firstly, because they're often the people that interface with young couples before they get married. So we've held a few rabbi meetings to make sure that they're up to date on what we're offering, so that when they meet a couple, when they're registering for their marriage, then they'll pass over information. But apart from that, we work with the synagogues to share information on social media. We partner with a lot of young professional organizations who are interacting with exactly the sort of people we want to get screened, and work on bespoke events, whether that's educational events or screening events. And also a lot of our work is on social media, so make sure everyone, they should check us out. But we just ran a big campaign during January, so we decided to rebrand January and call it January.
Yeah.
To basically focus our awareness raising efforts during that month. And we did a really a creative social media campaign focusing on personal stories. And a lot of young people nowadays, Instagram is where they are. So we're really trying to build our Instagram to make sure that people are following us and hearing about people's stories who've been screened and know exactly where to get screened. And also something we're working on at the moment is setting up a young committee, because we know that the most effective way of doing outreach is to get, you know, young people in the community doing the work for us. But if they can tell their friends this is something that's so important, it's going to work way better than us coming as, you know, this external type organization telling them you need to do this. But if people can spread the word of the importance of screening to their peers, it works a lot better. So
yeah, word of mouth is the best. So how has the past 12 months, have you had to change your modus operandi since the lockdown?
Yes, definitely. Obviously, like many charities, we had to react very quickly to the COVID situation. And the first thing we did was to trial a virtual screening, which means that literally everything was done virtually. And at some point during this conversation, Aviva can probably take the listeners through exactly what the screening process looks like. But we did trial a totally virtual screening, which was a big change from us, because prior to that, everything had been in situ. And it was hugely successful. And actually, as a charity, we've thrived through COVID, because we've been able to screen more people. We've been able to screen through a much wider geographical reach, all because the whole thing's been done virtually.
Well, it's been to your benefit, really.
It has, in terms of the numbers. I mean, we screen through...
I'll say to your benefit, it's to everyone's benefit.
To everyone's benefit. And we screen through 2 very different avenues. I mean, firstly, to mention the Jnetics clinic, which is targeted at 21 plus, and really at people who are beginning to think about starting a family. And they can sign up to the Jnetics clinic, and everything's online, and they can sign up, and the screening pack will be sent to them, and they'll be set up time with a genetic counsellor. And the other avenue is through our Genius programme. And our Genius programme is very much targeting year 12 students in schools, and university students on campus.
Oh, that's because you start at year 12 already, so they're aware of it from a younger age. So,
We start at year 12s. We're very much about shifting the mindset within the community. As a community, we're way behind what's happening in Israel, America, and Australia.
Oh, really?
Where screening is very much part of everyday life, and everybody thinking about embarking on parenthood would automatically look to be screened. In the UK currently, although things are changing, it's a very different story. And our view is that if we can hit sort of the youngsters as young as possible, then that's a big part of the job. And actually, in schools, the education side of things is as important as a physical screening. Because sure. We're teaching them about the disorders, teaching them about really what it means to be a carrier and what it means if your partner's a carrier and what you can do further down the line to prevent children actually displaying the genetic disorder.
That's great. So how do you do screening virtually?
So it's actually a really simple process. It works basically the same whether it's Genius screening event or the Jnetics clinic. So someone will just sign up.
What's the difference between the Jnetics clinic and the Genius program?
So Genius is for year 12 or university students.
Right.
Whereas the Jnetics clinic is for anyone in the community. So not a student it's more focused on 21 to 35, 21 to 40. So okay. Anyone who is postgraduate, post-university, who is going to be considering in the next, few years, 10 years, eventually starting their family. So with Genius, we run distinct screening events, whereas for the Jnetics clinic, that is an ongoing service that we run. So every month there's two clinics that people could sign up to, and that is just ongoing. So it's very convenient because any couple or any individual who thinks I need to get screened now, or we might want to try for a baby, can just go on a website and sign up and find the most convenient time for them. But
a saliva specimen or something like that?
Yeah, so someone signs up for a virtual appointment, which involves speaking to our genetic counsellor via video call. But right. Before they have the call, they'll get a pack in the post. So it's really easy. It's just a saliva kit and some paperwork. So that gives them everything they need for the appointment. Then they'll have their video call with the genetic counsellor, who'll run through all the key information about screening, about the disorder.
Will they do that with both parties, the boy and the girl?
So a couple doesn't need to both screen both at the same time. Unless right. They're really time pressured, maybe one of them might be pregnant or they really want to imminently try for a baby. But because the way these disorders work is that both partners have to be carriers of the same disorder for there to be a risk, it means you could get one of the partners screened, find out if they carry a disorder or not, and then based on that, decide whether the other one needs to get screened. Because if the first one comes back not as a carrier of any of the disorders, it means as a couple, they're not at risk of having an affected child.
Right, and they're good to go.
Exactly. It would be if one of them is found to be a carrier, then they would need to make sure that the other one is screened. So sometimes couples screen both together because they just want to find out quickly, but often it will just be an individual.
Right, because we've got a bit, like you say, you've got to both be carriers of the same disease in order for them to
yeah.
be.
Yes.
Now, what yeah. would you do if you have a couple where you find that both of them are indeed carriers of one of the 9 diseases that you can check for? How would you advise such a couple?
At that point, it would be picked up by the NHS. It's probably important for us to point out that we are very unique in that we have we work collaboratively with the NHS.
Right.
We actually employ people at Northwick Park Hospital who are responsible for all the genetic counselling. So they're very much involved with the process the whole way through. So at the point where two within a partnership, were found to be carriers, then they would be spoken to by the genetic counsellor who would basically talk to them about the options that were available to them and signpost them in the correct direction.
Okay, I mean, it's just thinking about it, it's amazing work you're doing. I mean, you're preventing, like you say, heartache, disease, illness, it's unimaginable. So I really hope that your message is going far and wide. Also, why do you think it's particularly prevalent amongst Ashkenazi Jews?
There is a theory that it's particularly prevalent amongst Ashkenazi Jews because all Ashkenazi Jews stem from as little as 300 people way back when. And that's really what's caused, it's the interbreeding that has caused the right. The problem with the genetic disorders.
We're all distantly related. You might be my 10th cousin, Mazal Tov.
I'm actually related distantly to Albert Einstein.
Oh, there you go.
You can tell. The intellect runs in the family. But I think it might be worth saying that it's not just people who are Ashkenazi Jewish that are at risk of certain genetic disorders, meaning actually across all different ethnic groups, there's going to be certain conditions that are more prevalent within that population. And there are disorders that are also increased risk for the Sephardi population too. So even Sephardi Jews are at risk. It depends on their country of origin. So Ashkenazi Jews, even though you might be from Poland, Russia, Germany, Lithuania, we're all at risk of the same disorders, but Sephardi Jews come from such a varied geographical area.
You've got Spanish and Portuguese, you've got Moroccan.
So there's some North African disorders, some Iranian, some, you know, some from different, I don't know, where else, Yemenite. So, but it's not just an Ashkenazi thing. People often think that, and it's not just a Jewish thing either. It's like Mediterranean people at risk of certain disorders, that kind of thing.
Right, but Nicole, you said earlier that you're going to extend to look to be able to investigate for more Sephardi prevalent disease.
There is a process that we have been going through, and there's been a great deal of research done over the last 12 months into what conditions what extra conditions we should be including in our panel, and that is still very much work in progress, although we anticipate by the start of the next school year, so September 2021, we will have a new panel. It will include some genetic conditions that are prevalent within the Sephardi community, as well as some other conditions that we should be testing for within the Ashkenazi community. So watch this space.
Okay, thank you. So finally, what would be your message to our viewers here today?
My message is simple. Get screened. If you're thinking about having a family, don't wait. Don't take the risk. One in five of us are actually carriers of one of these genetic disorders. And it's really important, one in five, which is high. Yeah. But as Aviva and I have said before, because the recessive genetic disorders, both members of the, because the recessive genetic disorders, it means that both within the couple would actually have to be carrying the same disorder before there was a 1 in 4 chance of any future children actually displaying the genetic disorder. So there is a risk to us all. It's a very simple test, and it's a spit test, and it's a lot easier than the corona test. So get screened and make sure that you aren't playing the lottery when you're thinking about going on to have children.
Wonderful. Well, that's a great message. Get the test. Details may be found below. You can always get in touch with us here at the shul if you'd like to be signposted to the right direction. We're here to help. I want to thank you, Nicole and Aviva, for joining us here
on
NLTV.
Thank you.
Kol hakavod for all the tremendous good work that you're doing, and I wish the charity good luck.
And thank you for having us. Good evening.
Well, that was interesting. You know, it's I think their awareness month is in January, right? Jnetics January.
They call it June. Why don't they just call June Jean?
No, it's January.
It's not like a specific pronunciation, Jean.
Right, but you know, I think, like you say, you know, it's always important to bring awareness to any cause. And you know, what was interesting in that is that, you know, we always hear about the Ashkenazi diseases, but you know, to know that there's also Sephardic as well, and the combination of the two. So it's
And they're always doing research into how new diseases and how that can also be prevented as well. So yeah, it's very, we did it 15 years ago and it worked. Baruch Hashem.
Baruch Hashem. Excellent. So thank you for that. So next up, we went over to Canada to meet the Korobkins, Rabbi Rebbetzin Korobkin, over in Toronto. They actually were here last year. You'll hear about that.
They're very inspirational. I remember when they came to our shul.
Right, that's right. They came for his call in residence. So let's go over to talk to Rabbi Rebbetzin Korobkin.
Rabbi Daniel and Rebbetzin Karen Korobkin, welcome to Narsli TV.
Thank you. It's nice to be back, at least virtually, in London. Yes, last time we saw you was a year ago. We were in your shul.
This time you were
home.
Lovely
time.
Yeah, and know, we didn't know that we'd have you back a year later, so it's fortuitous. So tell me, how you guys been over the last 12 months? It's not an easy time. You know, you have a lot to handle, a lot on your shoulders between the Bayit in Toronto and the Rabbinical Council of America presidency. Tell us about the last 12 months.
Oh, and how much time do we have? Rabbi and Rebbetzin, I have to say that seeing you brings back a whole year of memories. And the reason is because our last trip out of our home was being in London in your home.
Wow.
And so this is sort of like a bookend because it's literally exactly a year. The beginning of February, we had a new grandson. We were there for the bris. And then the next day we got on a plane to go to Israel for a conference. On the way back, we spent a Shabbos in your home and had a delightful experience at the shul that I affectionately called Hugs, even though I know that's not what anyone else calls it, but it's a place of, you know, HGSS and a beautiful, beautiful kihila. And
I don't even know what Hugs means anymore, does it?
No, we can just fantasize about it. And then the whole world was just descended into chaos. And literally, the Motzei Shabbat after Purim is when we made the decision to close the shul, which was just a couple of weeks after we were in London.
Was that your own decision? Did it come from, you know, the RCA?
I mean, this was something that it was a very dramatic moment. I mean, our entire executive board got together in a classroom in the shul on Saturday night, after Purim. And we were following the news. We were following the rates of infection, and it was a consensus with the doctors in our shul who are part of we have a COVID team, and the two physicians that are our advisors, who are members of our shul, said this is the right thing to do. It's you know, that people keep using that cliched word now. It's unprecedented. No rabbi ever thought that he would be in the position to say, we have to shut down. But in Canada, we are only, in Ontario, we are only allowed to have 10 people per service, but they allow you to break up into different rooms as long as they're completely separate services. So we can have minyanim on Shabbat, and we're only limited by the number of people who can lead service and read the Torah. And so on Shabbat morning, and we stagger the services starting at 7:30 in the morning all the way through 10 in the morning, we have services of 10 men each. And the sad part is women we cannot include, children we cannot include. And so we're waiting. We're just waiting until the province allows us to open up a little bit more. But this is since December that we've been in this. Wow. In this kind of lockdown.
Okay, we try to really, I mean, just challenging for all of us. We all know we're all in this together. So we do our best to reach out to as many people as possible, and everyone's got their own laws about they'll go on a walk, they won't go on a walk, depending on lockdown, what's happening. So like I try to reach out to as many people as I can. Just say, we have for our seniors, we have something called the Golden Girls. So every other Monday, we deliver a light lunch, and then a half hour later, they go on Zoom, and there's a program, the entertainer, or there's a speaker.
Yeah, one of our sons got married at the end of March this past year. Right. We were both, first of all, it was supposed to be in Montreal because he got engaged to a Canadian young lady. And so we thought we were just going to make an ofruf and a wedding and just drive over for a few hours to our neighbors in Montreal. And it turned out that they were closing the border. And so my son was fast on his feet, and he immediately flew out his fiance to come to LA, told her quickly, just pack, throw together whatever you need in one suitcase, just come. She left her wedding dress back in Canada. She flew to LA. We just, as much like until the almost like 2 days before, I still thought I could still go because I wanted to officiate at my own son's wedding. That's a rabbi's dream, right? To officiate at your child's wedding. I mean, thank God I've done it for other children as well, but sadly we couldn't. But the fact is, we watched it on Zoom, and he created, he went on Airbnb, and he was able to rent for the day a beautiful palatial home on a cliff in Malibu, overlooking the Pacific Ocean. They went into the backyard. They had a chuppah with his rabbi, his local rabbi, officiating, and just a minion of people. And, you know, with our kids and their and our kids' children, and my sister was there. And it was just, it was very, very moving. Now, a lot of people may think that that's a sad moment. But the fact of the matter is that it was sad for like a half a second. A half a second it was sad. But the joy that you have of seeing life going on is just amazing. And I'll tell you something, it's humbling as well. Because sometimes we think that we're the center, you know, how can life possibly go on without me being there? And the answer is, you know what? Your children will continue. They will continue living and their lives will go on with or without you. And it's beautiful, it's very touching, and it's also humbling at the same time, where we have to realize, you know, it's times like this when we start to think about the most important things in life. And just to be able to see our children go to that next chapter of their lives. They love us. We love them. We all know that. And we were able to come to terms with it very easily.
You know, we all know people who have delayed weddings, even bar and bat mitzvahs, and delayed just because of limits on numbers, you know, not to mention parents not being able to be at the simcha. And I think that, you know, your model of going ahead, not delaying a simcha, and there will be many, please God, many, many more simchas that you will celebrate with your newly wed children. People should have their simchas. People should have their simchas as soon as possible.
Let the simchas go on. Now, listen, I completely sympathize with people who wish to wait and see what will be. But what we've learned over the course of this year is that we cannot control the future. No matter how, you know, der Mensch tracht und Gott lacht, as the Yiddish phrase goes, man thinks and God laughs. This has never been more evident than over this past year.
What gets you guys through as a family through each day? Yes.
I think giving each other space, like even if you know that we're around, everyone has to find their corner, and it's really important. Otherwise you can get on each other's nerves. And it's just, you have to have music playing as much as possible and listen to your phones and be in your own world here and there. And there has to be a system, like the kids, like I told them at night, you know, they can't leave the after dinner, like they cannot leave the kitchen for a half hour. I'll wash, you dry, you take out the garbage, you, like they have to help, they have to be involved. Like there's no, I mean, you know, I don't eat all the food, but why should I clean up everything? You know, stuff like that. But also it brings us together as a team.
Karen and I are sitting in my man cave, which is my home office over here. And so if you talk about space, I mean, thank God I have a door to this room, and it does allow me this. It's my fortress of solitude, if I can use the Superman reference. But I will say that for me, the Shabbat is that island in time when we can come together as a family, that without Shabbat, I don't think we would have been able to fare as well as we have. We've been, you know, I know the Friedman home because we saw it. We saw you in action. You would normally be entertaining a whole army of guests every Shabbos, right? And your beautiful daughters would be part of that whole process. Now, because of COVID, we're not entertaining at all. And it gives us an opportunity to regroup as a family and to spend this priceless time together. I don't know that we would have been able to do that without COVID. And then I'll tell you one other thing that we do, like a ritual that we started years ago. In our family, Havdalah is a very special time, in that we and a family has to make a conscious effort to do this, because if you don't, everyone's ready to just run in their own directions once Shabbos is over, right?
Grab their phone.
So we do a very, very slow Havdalah, a musical Havdalah. And when we can get a musician to play the guitar or the violin, we will do that. And we do a very slow Karlbach Havdalah with lingering as much as we can. And when COVID started, we decided we were going to open that Havdalah to the congregation. So every Motzei Shabbat, we do the same Havdalah that we always used to do, but we do it over Facebook Live so that our congregation, and over Zoom so that our congregation can watch it. And then we do a little trivia or a 30-second mystery and let everyone see if they can guess. And then I do a goofy song where I take a song from my youth that I grew up with when I was a kid in California, and I put Jewish words to it, you know, something that's topical to COVID or to davening or whatever it is. And we sing that song using the karaoke, and we have a lot of fun with it.
If that's what it's all about, Bobby, if that's moving up, then I'm moving out. I have to hear it through the grapevine. Not much longer should we be confined. Oh, we hear it through the grapevine. And we're just about to lose our mind. And those drumbeat strains of the future remain in the beating of our hearts all day. You know sometime we're bound to leave here, but for now we've gotta stay. In the year of the bats,
there are people living alone in isolation. They can turn on their computers, feel that they're part of something bigger, and feel that embrace. And it's a great feeling to know that you've made a difference in someone's life, even from a distance.
Virtual hugs.
That's right.
Well, thank you so much. Thank you for your time. You guys are an inspiration, not only to all of North American rabbinate and jury, but personally, we're so fond of you guys. Thank you.
Same. It's a mutual admiration. Yeah.
And hopefully we'll see you back in London very soon.
Or in Toronto. Yeah. It's our turn to host you. It's Rat Hashem.
It's amazing. They had their son get married right when everything shut down. And I mean, you could hear the heart, you know, it's so hard to not be at your own son's wedding, yet they recognize that, you know, the show must go on. And
yeah, and to put the children first in a situation like that, I find that very inspirational.
And talking about simchas, we had a very interesting simcha here. You know, we had a bar mitzvah, the Davis, Toby Davis, that is going to celebrate his bar mitzvah Marble Arch, right? The actual Shabbos morning. Coincidence, the rabbi was speaking to him, and lo and behold, it was his Hebrew birthday, and he gets called up, his first aliyah.
With short notice to get to the shul.
Okay, over. Let's go over to meet the Davises.
Okay, so here we've got family Davis. Now, Toby, in the middle there, has just been called up this Thursday morning for his bar mitzvah. Today is Thursday morning, his Hebrew birthday. Standing next to his older brother, Jacob, the professional, who was bar mitzvah a couple of years ago. And they've got Max. When's yours?
4 years.
In 4 years? Well, I bet you're going to start learning now. Sadly, yes. Yeah. And Mazal Tov to Nick and to Vicky. So how was it this morning?
It was great. It was very good.
He was very good, yeah.
It was lovely.
And so were you pleased that he was able to actually come to the shul and do his laning?
Completely. We feel very lucky that we were able to actually be in shul.
Oh, that's very nice. So when are you celebrating the Shabbat?
The 20th of March.
Oh, so you've got plenty of time
Which is Toby's English birthday. Yeah.
Oh, that's excellent. Well, you are now officially bar mitzvah.
Yeah.
No more messing around. And you can always look at your brother for, you know, as a perfect role model.
Yeah,
you know,
exactly, yeah.
How Jewish adults behave. And we just want to wish you on behalf of the entire community a big, big Mazal Tov. And I bet you're looking forward, aren't you? You love the camera. Yeah. That's very good. So what will you be doing in March?
Parsha
Vayikra. Okay, and you doing that here or Marble Arch?
He's doing it at Marble Arch.
Okay. How lovely. Well, we wish you Mazal Tov. And all the best. Good luck.
Thank you.
Woo! amazing that they already had the masks paired already a month before, was it 2 months to go, and they already had their masks. It's amazing. Yeah,
forward thinking, but they're a lovely family, and it was so nice to see them at shul celebrating. It's lovely. We need more of that, and we're getting a lot of that, thank God. Baruch Hashem.
I mean, they said it was really, you know, and like we heard with the previous simchas, is I feel that this is the real thing, right? Even small, very intimate, but you know, it's the mitzvah that really makes a difference. And they feel
important. Thank God for weddings, you know, because my heart goes out to those couples who are desperate to get married and they can't. So
right, so
thank God soon,
very soon. We're getting we got those dates.
Yeah, so. In sight, but it's still a long time. Let's be honest.
Right, absolutely. But there's the end in sight, and that's what counts.
Yeah.
And so we end, you know, with our lockdown literature with Martin Kay. You know, he did disappoint us, and he had Goldie Bloom bring us the interview with her. What an interesting woman. Wow.
Yeah.
Such a diverse background. I actually joined the conversation with Martin. We did speak for an hour, but it was a little edited. And we're gonna see the full interview tomorrow night, but here is a little preview of what she speaks about. Let's go over to her.
This story is based on many people's actual life stories. I worked extremely hard with, and you know, people write about their own stories. And so when it comes to this though, I don't know, you know, when I look around my community, I see so many people that I'm very close with for more than 30 years, who have excellent relationships with their husbands. In writing this book, I felt, so often we're seen, the Hasidic community is seen from outside, people looking in, or it's seen from people who left and have feelings, right, about leaving. But it's so rare that there's actually a book written by a literary writer. Actually, I'm the first literary writer who's written a book from inside the Hasidic community.
Have you read the book? Have you finished the book, Rabbi Guttentag? I hear Gail read it in a day, just like you predicted, and gave it and dropped it over at your house.
I've started it, but no, I'm not finished. No.
Okay, so we didn't give away any secrets.
I'm still in chapter one, just at the part where she's worried about telling her husband that she's pregnant.
Right.
So yeah, it's a good reading.
You could watch the interview. We're very careful. We don't give away anything. So it's
just spoiler alert. I like that.
No spoiler alert. There's no spoiler alert. So it's really great. And you know, for the at Paragon, you know, we did get quite a few responses, but nobody was able to find the trivia from Martin Kay. You know, which biblical book does the author refer to? And
wasn't the prize a free book?
I know, but no, you know, it's very interesting. It was really tough. Like I myself had to review the interview a couple of times to hear it. And you know what? Here is a little snippet of it. It was, here's the answer.
Canto 1001, where it says, "We are a song of songs. We're all there.
Song of songs." But he says it really quickly and you really have to listen to it. And, you know, Martin is a little tough cookie. but anyway, so we look forward to hearing the interview tomorrow night, the rest of the interview, and he definitely has another book in store for next week, so look out for that as well. So thank you very much for joining us. Up after tomorrow night, we have another Chavrusa with Rabbi Saul Robinson, the Rabbi Jonathan Sachs books. Yep. And we look forward to bringing you more news and more local stories in your living room.
Hello.
Have a great week.